different from all of this. And the silence of the stars had no glimmer. The moon tries to hide, for in death lies the man of the blues. In a room filled with sorrow, a mother now cries, for Jesus, her son, now is gone. Her child came from heaven, now taken away. Heartbroken, she feels all alone. At the feet of the mother, a little boy cries, and he says, "Mama, I don't understand. For I remember the look of such love in his eyes, that I saw by the touch of his hand. The King of all ages, the very giver of life, for a moment is silent and still. Then a power comes from heaven, that shaking the night, and death must yield to its will. The storm moves, the earth shakes, the birds start singing, the sun shines, the earth warms, for new life it's bringing. Then a little boy stops crying, and the mother is smiling, for death cannot hold their king. Yes, a little boy stops crying, and the mother is smiling, for death cannot hold her.
Sabbath.
It's
good to see all of you here this Sabbath morning, and to share God's word, you know, together. I got a call Thursday night that Elder James was not well, and that I should be ready to come and share God's word. And so pray for me as we journey through this together. The title of the sermon, the message, is In Remembrance of Her. Kind of a little bit paradoxical. And, you know, we remember Jesus, but, you know, I'm saying that in remembrance of her. It comes from the passage that was read for us, and we're going to look at this together. You know, Elder Bill Jones has been talking about some great women of scripture, and certainly we have one here that we would do well to consider very carefully and think through what she did and the lesson that we can draw from her example. But before we get to her, we need to put the whole thing in perspective, in context, so that we can actually see the lesson that the passage, and of course the author would like to convey to us. I think I have shared this with you before, that in the Gospels, we're talking of the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Each evangelist writes from a different perspective, even though they are all doing the same story. Just as when we come upon some kind of accident on the highway, you know, there will be two, three of us, but we will all give a different report of the same event. And so we have that same thing happening in the Gospels. And so I pray that God will use this story to speak to you and to speak to me as we share this, you know, together. Please bow your heads as we seek the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Father, we submit to your lordship and to your authority. And we pray, God, that you alone will be heard, will be seen, will be felt. That all of us, Father, will pale into insignificance as Jesus, the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings and the ultimate, that unique Redeemer, takes center stage. So, sweet Spirit, fall afresh on us as we submit to you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I'm going to focus on Mark's gospel. And we will just make maybe a couple of references to the other gospels. And so my story, as it relates to this very special person, this woman, will be mainly drawn from the gospel of Mark. And so stay with me in this gospel. Now, when you read Mark's gospel, and I think we've shared this before, Mark, the author of the second gospel, paints a dismal, a very sad picture of the 12 disciples of Jesus Christ. Now, these disciples were chosen by Jesus. I think I've said this before, that I heard when I was growing up that, and from a good preacher, that all the disciples were chosen except Judas, and that's why he betrayed Jesus. And when I went to seminary, I discovered that that wasn't really the case at all. You know, that's what I heard, and I ran with that until I discovered that actually Judas was also called by Jesus. And I was a little bit disturbed because, you know, I don't think I was the only person that had been taught that. There were so many people that had embraced that teaching. And so let's just check this out. So that you don't say it comes from me, but it's actually in Scripture. Let's go to the Gospel of Mark. Take your Bibles and turn with me to Mark chapter 1. And let's look at verse 16 to verse 20, and then we will jump to chapter 3, 13 to 19, and we'll see how the disciples are mentioned and how Jesus actually called them. Let's begin from Mark chapter 1, beginning at verse 16. Jesus was walking by the Sea of Galilee when he saw Simon and his brother Andrew working with their nets in the lake, for they were fishermen. Jesus said to them, "Come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." At once they left their nets and followed him. Verse 19, going a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat mending their nets. At once he called them. They left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. Let's go to Mark chapter 3, verse 13 through 19, and we will find all the disciples named there, including Judas. Mark chapter 3, beginning at verse 13. Then he went up into the hill country and summoned the men he wanted. He called them. And they came and joined him. He appointed 12 to be his companions and to be sent out to proclaim the gospel with authority to drive out demons. The 12 he appointed were, so here we go, Simon, whom he named Peter, the sons of Zebedee, James, and his brother John, whom he named Boanerges, which is a Aramaic word meaning sons of thunder, Andrew, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Thomas, James, son of Alphaeus, Thaddeus, and Simon the Zealot, and finally Judas Iscariot, the man who betrayed him. So here we go, all the disciples are mentioned, including Judas. And so it's not true that Judas was actually not called, and that's why he betrayed Jesus. He was called, like the rest of the 12. And as Jesus began to call them from Galilee, where he began his ministry, according to Mark's outline, that is the second gospel, he taught them and he ate with them. They became his friends, his confidants. You know, he shared things with them. And from Mark chapter 1 to 8, the whole ministry of Jesus was centered in Galilee. And then in Mark chapter 8, beginning at verse 27, Jesus began to leave Galilee and make his way toward Jerusalem. Again, let's go there and check this out. Mark chapter 8, verse 27. The Gospel of Mark 8 and verse 27. Jesus and his disciples set out for the villages of Caesarea Philippi. And on the way, he asked the disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" Let's just stop there. And so from this point, from Mark 8 verse 27 to the end of Mark, Jesus now begins to depart Galilee, where he had begun his ministry with the disciples, and he focuses as he heads towards Jerusalem. It's kind of interesting because he is going to embark on a journey that is going to cause some people to be very uncomfortable. In fact, a journey that will lead Jesus himself to his death. And yet, it is also interesting to remember that he calls the disciples, and during this whole journey, he actually tried to prepare them for what would happen to him, to Jesus himself, as he confronted the Roman authorities, or what I may call Roman imperial power, concerning its violence to the people, and also the Jewish religious authorities for their injustices to their own people. And so Jesus sets him, you know, himself or his face toward Jerusalem as he began from Caesarea Philippi, and as he actually made his way, he taught the disciples all these things about the violence of the Roman imperial power against his own people, and then the religious authorities, the Jews themselves, you know, about the injustice to their own countrymen. Again, on this journey, Jesus began to prepare the disciples for their individual and communal participation in his death and resurrection. Let me say that one more time. This journey that Jesus had begun, moving away from Galilee, starting from Caesarea Philippi toward Jerusalem, was, to me more importantly, to prepare the disciples and all would-be followers for our individual as well as our corporate or communal participation in his death and also in his resurrection. But you know, as it turned out, and it gets a little bit sticky here, as it turned out to be, as they actually embark on this journey, Jesus had a core, you know, group made up of Peter, James, and John. And he took them everywhere he went, and he actually did confide in them. But not only these three, but the rest of the 12 as a group. And finally, Judas all failed Jesus tragically. And they refused to accept their own destiny alongside that of Jesus Christ. Have you thought about it? Has it happened to you? Now you see, the disciples were specifically chosen by Jesus, and they were given special instruction by him. In fact, when we go to Mark chapter 4, verses 10 and 11, I told you we'll stay in Mark's gospel for now. Mark 4 and verses 10 through 11, let me just read to your hearing. When Jesus was alone with the 12 and his other companions, they questioned him about the parables that he was using to teach. And here is his answer, verse 11. He answered, "To you, disciples, those close to me, the secret of the kingdom of God has been given. But to those who are outside, everything comes by way of parables." And so these close associates of Jesus were privy to something very special in the ministry of Jesus Christ, which others were not actually kind of, you know, made privy to or were not in the know. Now that makes it again very interesting. In fact, they were sent out and they were given success upon success. In fact, in their mission, they were able to cast out demons. Yet, or in spite of all the privileges that Jesus gave them, they were found wanting. Let me give you a few examples to show why the disciples, according to Mark's gospel, failed Jesus so tragically. Number one, they were found to be unperceptive and they lacked understanding about the true identity of Jesus Christ. Number one, very important. Now let me give you an example to back that up. You remember the story of Jesus on the sea? Mark chapter 4, verse 35. A strong storm arose. And these are hard, steady fishermen. That wasn't the first time they had been on the sea. They've spent all their lives on the sea. And as soon as the waves rose and things began to kind of get a little bit topsy-turvy, they began to shake. They go to Jesus and they, you know, "Master, why are you sleeping? Don't you care that we are perishing?" And Jesus rises up. He commands the waves, the sea, the storm, everything, and it all became quiet. And the disciples trembled. They became afraid, saying, "Who is this man that even the winds and the sea obey him?" Think about it. You see, they have been with Jesus, and yet they're asking this question. That's number one. Number two, they failed to understand Jesus with respect to the miracle of feeding the 5,000 with five loaves and two fish. Now again, if you want to put that down, Mark chapter 6, verse 52. Go there and you see this interesting story. Let me just read what they say to, you know, what Jesus says to them. Mark chapter 6, verse 52. And you notice that they really were just lost. They didn't understand what was going on. And so Jesus said, "For they had not understood the incident of the loaves." Why? Because their minds are closed. Have mercy. This is a huge indictment. Now I want you to put yourself in the disciples' shoes. I'm putting myself as we travel, as we go through this story. So don't just kind of have this distance between you and the story. I want you to put yourself there. I'm doing that right now as I share this with you, so that it becomes more meaningful and relevant, you know, to us. Again, third time, they failed to understand the miracle of feeding the 4,000. Mark chapter 8, verses 14 to 21. You know, Jesus used 7 loaves to feed 4,000 people, and they were again lost. There's also this misconception about the ministry of Jesus. You see, right just around the middle of the Gospel of Mark, from chapter 8 going, the disciples seem to understand a little bit about what is going on. in their relationship with Jesus Christ. And they actually began to see something special about Jesus Christ. That this Jesus seemed to be the authoritative agent of God. But again, they draw the wrong conclusions. Let me give you an example. You remember in Mark chapter 8, Peter's confession, "You are the Messiah." Now Jesus asked them, "Who do you think that I am?" And people were giving all kinds of, reasons. And Peter said, "You are the Messiah, the Son of God." And then Jesus says, "Man, only God's Spirit could have revealed this to you." And then immediately after that, what happens? When Jesus tells them that the Son of Man is going to Jerusalem, and there he will be killed, and he will rise up in 3 days. Now Peter says, "Master, Master, you can do that." And Jesus had to tell him, "Get behind me, Satan." Now here you are, somebody who had just confessed Jesus as the Messiah. Within the next breath, Jesus tells him, "Get behind me, Satan." So again, you see the problem. That even though they are beginning to understand something about Jesus, they still draw the wrong conclusions about things that were going on. Another example. Mark chapter 9, verses 1 to 8. This is the story of the transfiguration. Really powerful story there. Jesus takes the three disciples, the inner core, Peter, James, and John, and they go up on the mountain, and there he was transfigured. His appearance changed, and something dramatic takes place. Two individuals appeared with Jesus. And who were they? Moses and Elijah. Now, I think I've shared this before, but there's a beautiful story behind this. In Jewish tradition, Moses and Elijah are the only two individuals who ascended to God's presence and were expected to return. In other words, these two individuals did not die. Even though we read about Moses kind of being shown the promised land, and then, he disappears. Nobody knows where he was buried. Now, the understanding is that Moses was assumed, was taken to heaven. Now, in the case of Elijah, we know that. You know, when he was with Elisha, that whirlwind came and what? Took him. So, he did not die. And so, in Jewish tradition, Moses and Elijah are two clearly distinct individuals who didn't die, and the expectation is that they would return. Now, it's really interesting. Think about this for a moment. As these two heavyweights come to Jesus, a voice comes from heaven to actually set Jesus apart from these two great men of Judaism. Moses, the greatest constitutional expert, the one who gave Israel its identity. Elijah, the prototype prophet. No prophet had arisen greater than Elijah. And so these are two heavyweights. And yet this voice comes, "This is my beloved son." Do what? Listen to him. And so even in the midst of these two great giants, Jesus is set apart as the one who is unique. Again, they fail to understand. Amen. Have mercy, Lord. Amen. Have mercy. You see, it's getting very difficult here for the disciples, as far as Mark's gospel is concerned. I wish the story ended there. But there's more. The disciples further entertain the mistaken notion that they were going to be great in the kingdom of God. You see, as soon as Jesus tells them that, again, I'm going to Jerusalem, the Son of Man will be mistreated, he will be handed over to the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders, they will kill him. In 3 days' time, he will rise again. As soon as he says that to them, you know what happened? James and John go to Jesus. "Master, when your kingdom comes, why don't you make us the two greatest in the kingdom? Let me sit on your right hand and let my brother sit on your left hand. Are you getting me there? Are you following me? You see, again, they don't understand what's going on. And then the disciples all got mad and they began to fight among themselves. And then Jesus takes a little child and he began to teach them that the kingdom is not like the way you are thinking about. I think it's probably a good idea to just go there. It's a beautiful passage. Mark chapter 10, verse 35 to 45. Mark chapter 10, 35 through 45. Let me read through this, you know, quickly. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Mark 10, beginning at verse 35, approached him and said, "Teacher, we would like you to do us a favor. What is it that you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked them. They answered, "Allow us to sit with you in your glory, one at your right hand, the other at the left." Jesus said to them, "You do not understand what you are asking. Can you drink the cup that I drink or be baptized with the baptism that I'm baptized with?" "We can," they answered. Jesus said, "The cup that I drink, you shall drink. The baptism that I'm baptized with shall be your baptism. But to sit on my right or on my left is not for me to grant. That honor is for those whom it has already been assigned." Now, this is very important, because as we move through this story and as we get to this special character that I'll be introducing in a moment, that character seemed to fit this last part. The honor is for those to whom it has been assigned. No predestination here, but something that Jesus is saying to the disciples to prick them up, for them to sit up and to listen and to see what is, you know, what this kingdom business is all about. And yet they do not understand. It is a very dismal story here, ladies and gentlemen. But take heart, don't be too much discouraged. Now, as we move on again, we see other things happening in the story. You know, the disciples all abandoned Jesus and fled. You know, when it actually mattered most, when Jesus needed their help, just turn with me to Mark chapter 14. It's kind of, you know, let the Bible speak for itself. You know, that way, when you go from here, you know it came from Scripture. Mark chapter 14 again. We stay with Mark's gospel. And let's look at verse 50 and 51. Mark 14 verses 50, 50 and 51. Now, let me back up and read from verse 47. "One of the bystanders drew his sword, struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his ear." Verse 48, "Jesus spoke, 'Do you take me for a thief that you have come out with swords and cudgels to arrest me? Day after day I have been among you teaching in the temple, and you did not lay hands on me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled.'" Now here we go, verse 50. "Then the disciples all deserted him and ran away." They fled for dear life. Now here are his friends. When he needed them most, they all abandoned him and fled. You know, again, I wish it just stopped there. You know, as we go further down in the chapter, what did Peter do? Peter betrays, or, you know, before the cock, you know, crows three times, Peter what? Betrays his master. I don't know him at all. You know, it took only a little girl, a very young girl, to say, "Man, you look like one of his disciples." And then what did, you know, Peter do? Read the scriptures. He began to curse. "Man, I don't know this guy. What are you talking about? I haven't been with... come on, get out of here. I don't know him." And then Jesus turns his face graciously with love, looks straight at Peter, and Peter bows his head. "Have mercy, Lord. Have mercy, Lord." And I wish the story had ended there. Finally, Judas, in the scripture reading, began to seek a way to betray his master. Let's go back to the scripture reading. Mark chapter 14, verses 1 to 11. And we are going to introduce a character in contrast to what these disciples have done. Now follow me very carefully here. Mark 14 verses 1 to 11. Let me read and enjoy this in my beautiful African accent. You know, it's really nice. So I want you to enjoy this word. So hear me out here. It was 2 days before the festival of Passover and unleavened bread. And the chief priests and scribes were trying to devise some scheme to seize him and put him to death. Are you following me so far? Are you enjoying it? Are you enjoying it? Okay, good. I want you to enjoy it. It must not be during the festival, they said, or we should have rioting among the people. Now, verse 3. Follow me carefully here. Jesus was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper. As he sat at table, a woman, have mercy, thank you, Jesus, came in carrying a bottle of very costly perfume, pure oil of nard. She broke it open, poured the oil over his head. Verse 4. Some of those present said indignantly to one another, "Why this waste? The perfume might have been sold for more than 300 denarii, and the money given to the poor." And they began to scold her. Verse 6. But Jesus said, "Leave her alone." Let me repeat. Leave her alone. Why make trouble for her? It is a fine thing she has done for me. You have the poor among you always, and you can help them whenever you like. But you will not always have me. She has done what lay in her power. She has anointed my body in anticipation for my burial. Truly, verse 9. Truly, I tell you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed throughout the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her. Hence my sermon title, In Remembrance of Her. Then Judas, one of the 12, went to the chief priest to betray Jesus. You see a sharp contrast here. Now let me walk through this carefully with you. Please listen here. Contrast the dismal picture of the disciples failing and betraying Jesus with the incident of this action, or the action that we just read about, by an unnamed woman. Are you with me, you know, this morning? Her name is not given, by a nameless woman. Now follow me, let's walk through this carefully. By a nameless woman. Now, don't let us confuse this story. There's another story in Luke chapter 7 about another woman who goes to anoint Jesus in the house of a Pharisee. That is a different story. Let us focus on this story just in Mark's gospel. Now, according to the account, the oil was of great value. Are you with me again? In fact, some manuscript says that this whole oil she had to save for one whole year to be able to afford that. Again, are you with me? Yes. All right. Third, this woman goes and anoints the head of Jesus. Have mercy, Lord. She anoints the head of Jesus. Let me back up again. We're talking about a nameless woman. No name. And she is a woman, for that matter. You know where I'm going. And She saves for a whole year. She buys a very expensive oil. And she goes and she anoints the head of Jesus. Think about that. Are you with me so far?
Yeah.
Can you see the contrast here? A nameless woman who goes to Jesus and anoints Jesus in the context of the impending death of Jesus Christ. You see, we don't celebrate Lent within our Adventist calendar, but this is a special time in the Christian calendar called Lent, beginning from Ash Wednesday to Easter. And, you know, the Christian church believes that Lent is a time when we fast, when we pray, kind of putting emphasis on that. We do that throughout the whole year, but for the Christian church, we pray more, we fast more, we do alms, we give, you know, kind of become, you know, penitential penance, all kinds of things, what we call seasons of awareness. Now, let me suggest that this woman did this act within the season of Lent, because Jesus was preparing to die. And she goes and she anoints Jesus. And then the disciples, and this is where I find it hard to understand, but maybe not hard, because I would have done the same if I were there. Maybe he would have done even worse. All of us would have done worse. They began to scold her. In other words, they are by extension scolding Jesus. Why, Master, do you allow this woman, this poor woman, to spend this amount of money to buy this oil and just to anoint your head? Your head. Don't you think it would have been better spent if we had kind of sold it, gotten the money, use it to feed the poor, and that would have been okay? Good excuse, good reason, nothing wrong about that. But you see where the story is going now? You know, this story becomes interesting. Let me submit to you that in the Gospel of Mark, this woman becomes the first believer. Praise God. Now read Mark's Gospel. This nameless woman becomes the first believer in the Gospel of Mark, not the disciples. In fact, for us, she becomes the first Christian woman. The first Christian ever to follow Jesus in Mark's Gospel. It gets exciting for me at this point. Because here is a woman. In that culture, women were not, you know the story. And to make it even worse, she didn't even have a name. Now think about it. Nameless, unnamed woman. And she saves a whole year's wage and she buys this. And she comes to anoint the head of Jesus. You know, this woman gets it. The disciples didn't get it, but this woman got it. Thank God for our woman this morning.
Amen.
Oh, you should say more amen to that.
Amen.
Thank God for our woman. Is that right? Well, you see, men, we've got to do better.
Amen.
You know, here you are with all these 11 or 12 men working with Jesus all these years, and they failed to understand what Jesus was all about. It took that perceptive woman to know where Jesus was going. Are you with me this morning?
Amen.
And for this nameless woman to actually anoint Jesus for what was coming. Very perceptive. Spiritual things are spiritually discerned. Only God's Spirit could reveal that to that woman. And she embraced that and she acted upon it. Hence, she becomes the first Christian woman in Mark's Gospel. Not Peter, not James, not John. This woman is the first Christian woman in the Gospel. In fact, let me step aside and even say that Bible students believe that Mark's Gospel was the first of the four Gospels to be written. So if that's the case, then we can actually suggest then that this woman is the first woman who actually takes the word of God out, not the disciples, you know, in the book of Acts, you know, until the disciples later on come in and began to actually spread the word. This woman becomes the first Christian woman. You see, this unnamed woman is a graphic demonstration of the paradoxical leadership that Jesus has been talking about in Mark's gospel. Jesus talks about being like a child, being like a servant, being like a slave. You see, she is, as far as I'm concerned, a slave, if you like, with no standing in society, with no name. But she gets it, while the disciples who have been with Jesus fail to understand his mission. But before I conclude, let me throw in another thing that kind of humbled me and gave me a lot of respect as I read this story for this woman. Finally, this woman participates in the glory of Jesus Christ. She is the only person to whom the words of Jesus, spoken over the communion, over the Eucharist, the Lord's Supper, is applied. Nowhere in Scripture do we find these special words of Jesus. And we do in the communion, we say these words every time. But these words are applied only uniquely to this woman in this gospel. Allow me to share this with you. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. This is a fascinating story. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. The first ever recorded words of the Eucharist, in other words, of the Lord's Supper. And here is what Paul is saying, and allow me to share this with you and put this in perspective with what Christ said about this woman. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, begin at verse 23. Here is what Paul is saying. 1 Corinthians 11, 23 to 26. For the tradition which I handed on to you came to me from the Lord himself, that on the night of his arrest, the Lord took bread, and after giving thanks, broke it. This woman broke that bottle to anoint the head of Jesus. Again, that symbolism shouldn't be lost. And said, "This is my body, which is given for you." Now here we go. "Do this in remembrance of me." Are you with me this morning? Amen. All right, now let's continue. In the same way, he took the cup after supper and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, or by my blood. Whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes." In remembrance of her. You know, this is kind of interesting. See, the disciples were angry with her for what they considered to be an extravagant waste. And in fact, that led to Jesus offering this unique and stunningly extraordinary accolade. And please go back to Mark 14, verse 9. "Truly, I tell you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed in the world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her." As I bring my sermon to a close, I just want you to think about something. You see, this woman not only accepted the substitutionary death of Jesus, but she was also willing to participate. Are you with me this morning? It is one thing to accept Jesus' death, substitution for us. And in our Western mindset, substitution makes more sense. A good God was angry, something was wrong, and so Jesus had to come and die. Oh, good, that's fine. But in Mark's gospel, while the substitutionary death is important, what is more important for the writer is that we participate in the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. This morning, ladies and gentlemen, this woman's story beckons us, invites us, not only to appropriate the substitutionary death of Jesus in our lives, but also we are invited to participate in this death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The songwriter writes, "All to Jesus I surrender. To him I freely give. I will ever love and trust in him because he's done it all for me." I invite you to participate in the death of Jesus Christ. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for coming down to our sin-sick world to die for us and to give us the assurance that you are always with us, inviting us to participate daily in this act of sacrifice which you have done on our behalf. I pray, O God, that you will give each one of us that spiritual determination like this woman had to give it all to you, our lives, our all, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.